Welcome to the Orbiter Dimensions mini-lecture. The notes page for this lecture can be found in your notebooks on either page 20 or 24. This is the Space Transportation System. This vessel is commonly called the shuttle. Many people call this alone the shuttle, but in fact, the entire STS, or Space Transportation System, is the shuttle. The ship alone is called the orbiter. You will have to know this, so make sure you write down the dimensions I'm about to tell you. The orbiter alone, from its nose to its three main engines, is 112 feet long. From the nose to the tail, the orbiter is 122 feet long. The tail actually sticks out an extra 10 feet from the engines. The wingspan of the orbiter is 78 feet long, and from top to bottom, or tail to landing gear, the orbiter is 55 feet tall. On to the SRB, or solid rocket booster. The orbiter alone cannot launch itself into orbit. It needs two of these very high-powered rockets. They're called solid rocket boosters because of the fuel they contain. It is solid, explosive fuel rather than normal liquid fuel. The fuel is then distributed into numerous cakes of explosives, which are loaded into the SRBs. It is 149 feet tall and has a diameter of 12 feet. Next in the STS is the ET, or external tank. It is merely a fuel tank that provides liquid rocket fuel to the orbiter's three main engines. Its thickness is about that of a nickel. It is 154 feet in height and 27 feet in diameter. All of these components make up the Space Transportation System, and altogether, the four stacked up parts of the STS are 184 feet tall. From the top of the tail to the belly of the STS, the ET, is 75 feet. As you see here, the wings stick out over the SRBs, which means that the width of the STS is the same as that as the orbiter, which is 78 feet. There were six orbiters that were ever built, but only five ever flew. The order that the five first flew was Columbia, Challenger, Discovery, Atlantis, and then Endeavour. An easy way to remember this is CCDAE. The letters each stand for the first letters in the names of each of the orbiters. Columbia, Challenger, Discovery, Atlantis, and Endeavour. Columbia, the first orbiter, flew in 1981 and perished in 2003. As you see here, material fatigue causes materials to become brittle and easily breakable. I'm going to demonstrate with this paperclip, which will break with one more bend. The same applies for hot and cold. It happened to one of the wings of Columbia. The constant change from hot to cold and back again caused the wing to become brittle. Upon liftoff, a piece of foam fell off of the external tank and hit the leading edge of the wing, causing a crack. When the shuttle arrived at the space station, they didn't bother to check for imperfections. Upon re-entry, the heat caused the wing to melt off because of the crack. The lack of aerodynamics caused the shuttle to spin in the Earth's atmosphere and burn up. The pieces of Columbia shot over the Earth's sky. The next orbiter in the fleet was Challenger. It first flew in 1983 and perished in 1986. On the day of one of the launches, it was so cold that one of the separators of the fuel in the SRB, or O-ring, shrunk. Because of this, only minutes into the flight, a hot jet of thrust shot out of the SRB, but in the wrong direction. It shot right at the ET, which is very thin. It ripped through the metal easily and ignited the fuel all at once, causing the orbiter to explode. However, the cockpit portion was not destroyed in the initial explosion, but the fall back to Earth, hitting the water, was like hitting concrete. The entire crew sadly perished. The next orbiter in the fleet was Discovery. It first flew in 1984 and still has not perished. The next was Atlantis. This orbiter first flew in 1985 and is still intact today. The last of the orbiters was Endeavour. This orbiter first flew in 1992 and has not perished either. Now I'm going to ask you to turn back two pages in your notebook to the thrust page. There are three names or nicknames for the Space Transportation System. The shuttle, because it is used to transport materials back and forth from the space station. The stack, because it looks like a stack once it's all stacked up. And the Space Transportation System, for obvious reasons. The last pieces of information you have to know in this mini lecture is the thrusts of the STS. One main engine alone produces 375,000 pounds of thrust, and all three together produce 1.1 million pounds of thrust. When SRB produces 2.6 million pounds of thrust, and both produce 5.2 million pounds of thrust together. Altogether, the STS produces 6.3 million pounds of thrust, and that's how much thrust it takes to get the orbiter into orbit. Any questions?